Hello guys, and welcome to BizOM University webinar. I'm Mansi Srivastav. We'll wait for 2 more minutes for people to join in and then we'll start the webinar. Hi guys, good evening and welcome again to BizOM University webinar. In the current times, the retail industry is in a dire need to ensure a smooth influx of working capital to stay strong. In today's webinar, we are talking to Finnovate Capital, which is an innovative fintech platform that is providing short-term finance to MSME and SME businesses. They are looking to combine the traditional approach of credit distribution with a state-of-art fintech platform to bring together best of both worlds and drive immense efficiency in an erstwhile traditional business. From Finnovate Capital, we have Aljo Joseph, who is serving as a co-founder and chief business officer. Aljo is a serial entrepreneur with over 15 years of experience in business incubation and management consulting with cross-sector experience across finance, FMCG, and manufacturing. Business strategist for a large global MNCs, certified enterprise architect, and startup mentor are some of the hats he wears. Aljo is also an avid golfer and cyclist. Aljo, welcome to the webinar.
Thanks, Mansi. Happy to be here as well.
This session is moderated by Krishna Kothari, CEO of BizOM UK. Krishna has 15 years of experience in advising clients across FMCG, retail, pharmaceutical, and insurance industries to leverage information and analytics across a range of strategic challenges. He's very passionate about creating innovative, cognitive, and analytics solutions to help clients solve problems using the vast amount of data that is available today. Krishna, welcome to the webinar.
Hey, thanks, Mansi. Lovely to have you, Aljo. Welcome to the webinar. Hello, everyone.
Yeah. Hey, thanks, Krishna. Excited about the conversation as well.
The format of the webinar is the 40-minute of discussion, which is followed by 15 minutes of Q&A at the end. You guys can post your questions during the webinar under the Q&A tab, which you can see on the right of your screen. And we'll take up those questions in the last 15 minutes. Now, without wasting a minute, let's start the discussion. Krishna, over to you.
Thanks, Mansi. Thank you so much. Hello, everyone. So, Aljo, as we were just discussing, I mean, before we get into the nitty-gritties and kind of go deeper into FMCG route to market success, I'll really like some kind of basic demystifying of some of the jargons when we talk about supply chain financing and, you know, and credit and some of the things that you do through your platform. So why don't you just tell us a little bit about, you know, supply chain financing, what you guys do and how do you create value for organizations?
Absolutely. And I think just keeping it simple is very important out here, right? I mean, let's leave out supply chain financing. What Finnovate Capital tries to do is maximize the impact that we can have on the working capital profiles of SMEs and also the brands that they're associated with. So the way we do that is that we provide them unsecured working capital. And you know, Given that you're from this background, you understand how important that word is, right? I mean, traditionally, SMEs have never been able to get financing without hypothecating something or keeping some FD in the bank. So the whole idea is, how do we make unsecured financing available to the SMEs? So what we've realized is we have to work with the strongest links in the chain to make that possible. The strongest link in this case, in the FMCG context, is the brand that they're associated with. The other piece that we use as the cornerstone of what we do is what we say is, if there is a distributor, a stockist, or a retailer who's been associated with you for more than 10 years, the way you underwrite him has to be fundamentally different from the way you underwrite somebody who's just joined you 3 months ago. These sort of weightages have traditionally not existed. And if any of these people went directly to the lenders, they typically would not get financed as well. So what we specialize in doing is creating these cohorts that are palatable to the various lenders who work with us. So we've got 22 lenders who work with us, of whom there are 10 strategic lenders. That means we work back with the credit committees to include more and more cohorts. And that's where we work back, on the basis of the power of the data to create this sort of inclusion. I'm hoping it's not just too much of jargons just yet, right? Does this work?
Very, very clear. Very clear, Aljo. So if I talk about, let's talk about those particular kind of SMEs that you work with. As you talked about distributors or some stockists, even retailers. So how does one go about doing this? I mean, getting unsecured loans sounds really, really great. But kind of, what are those kind of basic criteria that the brand should think about? How can they go about this?
Absolutely. So I think when you kind of look at bringing unsecured financing to the retailers, and first of all, or just the entire channel, right, from a sales standpoint, what you've got to think of is most strategically saying, which are the channels that I really want to grow, right? Which are the channels that I'm confident in? And effectively, what we do is, on the basis of your historical information, we carve out certain limits which are for exclusive use with you, right? So as a brand, whenever you wake up every morning, you'll have a dashboard that gives you a view saying that, hey, this particular stockist has so much of limit available with him, which he has to use with you. It is true with the distributor and the retailer as well. So you're no longer in a reactive mode where you're reaching out and checking, hey, do you want something, right? It's an exclusive use limit. So if the limit is available, you can push goods down the channel.
So how are the risk profiles of some of these guys? Kind of, where is the risk then being managed? I mean, if it is, you talked about underwriting it in a different way, but how what's the risk profile that you help brands kind of almost evaluate to identify the right credit limits for the right channel or even the right party that you are trying to finance?
So almost everything that we do is very custom, right? So like for every brand, the way you do channel finance varies based on the strength of the brand, right? And the presence of those king and queen SKUs, right? The fundamental thing that you start off with is, what is the risk of substitution, right? What would stop this person in the entire channel to switch from this brand to the other, right? And fundamentally, till the time you're able to not answer that question, you don't really proceed, right?
Yeah.
Or you proceed conservatively with a cohort that you're absolutely certain won't switch, right? So that's what we enable the brands to determine. And we come up with a fairly large list of filter criteria, right? On the basis of that, we identify the segment that we could cater to. And within that segment, we usually have a very, very high conversion rate, right? So the biggest problem that the brands face is, if they do offer financing, we all know the financing typically tends to be between 15 and 25%, right? In the open market. And that creates a bigger reputational risk. The way supply chain finance or affinity finance, like we call it, comes through is when you're able to say, hey, you're eligible now. You're getting this limit only because you're associated with me. So you can use this only with me. And in these cohorts, our approval rates are almost upwards of 90%.
Wow.
Right. It almost sounds unbelievable when I say it, but we actually have 0% NPA on our platform.
That is some statistics, Aljo. We're talking about FMCG, kind of probably one of the most complex ecosystems that exist.
Correct.
And as Bizom, we have been kind of helping hundreds of brands to get that visibility of what's happening at every stage. So as you kind of identify that these are the channels or these are my business lines that I think I need to grow, and hence I need to be able to finance my partners better. How do you manage this kind of multi-tier kind of ecosystem that exists in FMCG? Does kind of financing kind of start at one end, or is it kind of across the whole chain? What's the, I'm sure there is no one direct formula, but kind of how do you manage that complexity?
No, it's a very important question, and it is something that needs to be done correctly, right? Because first of all, very few people understand this, and if not managed properly, it sets up a very risky financial profile for the industry. Because what you've got to understand, it's essentially the same good that is moving down the entire channel, right? And mm-hmm. and what you don't want to do is double and triple finance the same commodity. Because yeah. what that means is that if one person goes down in the entire chain, three of them go down together, right? Correct. So effectively setting the structures correctly to ensure that this doesn't happen is the most important thing. So classically, what you would do is, and you would not do it for every participant in the ecosystem. You will identify certain stockists that you want to cultivate. Then you cultivate their distributors. You build comfort at each level for some time before going down to the lowest tier.
Correct. I mean, yeah, not do what the bankers did in leading up to 2008 financial crisis, leveraging a single mortgage 30 times and then creating the bubble that will burst.
Absolutely. And as fintechs, I think while we create inclusion, we also have to be responsible in terms of how we kind of, you know, create this entire ecosystem so that it's sustainable.
Absolutely. I wanted to kind of get into some real examples, helping our audience understand the value this can unlock. For a brand. And Alju, we were just talking about kind of dairy as a vertical in particular, and which kind of you said you were really excited that it is kind of a perfect vertical, a perfect storm that you have created within dairy. Would you like to tell us a little bit more about what you are doing there?
Absolutely. So what we've done specifically, and everyone's style of functioning is different, right? I mean, what we understand is in the Indian FMCG ecosystem, everyone's come up with their own logic to manage credit and risk, right? I mean, yeah. That's traditionally what's happened. To the extent possible, you've hived off all your credit to the stockist, and he's basically a financier through the entire chain. Right now, in this context, the way you kind of design it is very different for different brands. But specifically, in this particular case, what we did was there was a need to kind of manage the way you gave credit out in the market, right? Because there was a lot of informal credit, there was a lot of paperwork. I mean, there was a lot of tracking which was happening on Excel sheets for them, right? Mm-hmm. So by just us coming in there and putting that dedicated limit with an induced control, just streamlined mm-hmm. the entire thing. Now, in this case, we're talking about 800 stockists that were associated with the dairy company, of uh-huh. whom, based on the filter criteria, we were able to carve out and say it's about 600 or 550 odd that were eligible on the basis of the first set of lenders that we bought in. Mm-hmm. We've got four lenders on the program. With one integration with us, we've got four lenders who can finance our entire portfolio. Because each lender looks at different cohorts, my ability to include those distributors also goes up significantly. And the approval rate on this program within those cohorts has been about 90%. The limit has been churning 2x every month.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So right? Even in these times.
Even in these times, which is fabulous, and we'll touch on. And there will be any webinar in the current times where we'll not talk about the impact of COVID on the business. I mean, so we will talk about that. But just drilling down a bit further, so 800 of about 550 stockists, who are eligible. You've identified a range of lenders who can meet the demand and the needs of that kind of a portfolio of distributors. What is that impact that it has created? So when you said 2x has been, so in terms of percentage of market share that the brand has been able to achieve, or the growth, or the number of rotations that the distributors have been able to increase, could you share some of those insights?
Very, very early days into the program, but I do wish I could have shared that, because it is going to be very interesting on that one. But having said that, we definitely do see substitution happening based on what we're hearing on the ground, right? Mm-hmm. Because it's a dedicated limit and the compete is not giving the limit out there. So people are preferring to transfer the business to the brand that's giving the limit. So that is something that we're hearing very actively on the ground. I think we'll have to run this for a couple of more months and also, if there is a post-COVID world, right? I mean, depending on whatever that looks at, we'll have to look at those numbers for a couple of months before, you know, coming up with, before throwing statistics out in a public forum.
Yeah, but I think substitution is a fantastic kind of an example that you talked about. I mean, typically a brand, in our estimation, will spend anywhere between 30 to 50% of their top line on their route to market. So for a $1 billion company, you're spending $300 to $500 million in route to market, and there are kind of and there are huge investments that you are doing now. And one of the largest kind of pieces that a lot of brands are struggling with, that I want to have direct reach to a lot of these retail outlets, 15 million of them in India, and that's a very expensive business. Through substitution, are you seeing that some of that opening up of the channel, acquisition of the retailers becoming easier for those stockists and hence for the brand as well?
Absolutely. But I think it goes a little deeper than that, right? So effectively, especially in this COVID scenario where almost everyone is struggling with distribution, right? This is the opportunity for people to actually grab shelf share, right, at the retailer, if you're already there. So first of all, I mean, it also requires you to be responsible in terms of how you use the limit, right? So what you should not be doing is dumping your slow moving SKUs and blocking up the limits, right? As long as you are conservative about the SKUs that you're dumping on the retailers and they move at a decently, you know, good clip, you can identify similar or complementary categories that exist where you don't have presence, which the retailer stocks. Right. Yeah. So we are seeing those things happen, right? Like, for instance, people in dairy moving into idli and dosa batter, right? I mean, or just deciding to start on a, you know, curd line as an example, or a paneer line, right? Yeah. And with the limit, and if you know that these churn fast enough, you can do all of this.
Yeah, I mean, they have a cold supply chain already. They have the distribution kind of infrastructure set up in place. So they're leveraging that to kind of drive growth, both, I'm assuming, both for themselves, but obviously for the retailer ultimately.
Absolutely.
who is now braving the new world, opening the outlets in the current environment. Now that's fascinating to hear. I mean, we've also heard over the last year that people have got into interesting extensions of their brands and moving into sanitizers and doing different things, which was quite completely unusual for these guys. I mean, if I so what were the bottlenecks kind of before this started? I mean, you talked about substitution, you talked about increasing the reach, and giving the brand the ability to drive that better reach. But what were the bottlenecks? You know, there must have been some hesitancy to kind of part with their capital, and so what kind of those barriers that you saw as you moved through this, Aljo?
So like I said, I mean, in the Indian FMCG context, there is no one size fits all, right? I mean, there are some people who take deposits from the stockist before they give anything out there, and they fund to a certain percentage. They have to, and then it's more like, you know, I'm giving credit out in the market, so I don't have the capability to manage credit. I require to manage peak limits. How do I do that? Right. So just getting us in helped solve all those problems. Right. Am I answering? Did I get the question right, Krishna?
Yeah. I mean, it's such a kind of part of it is absolutely correct. I mean, the other part is it's also a behavioral change, which you want the brands to kind of drive that internally. If they have been historically driving credit limits for outlets in a particular way, before you take the next order, do the collection for the previous order, managing credit in a different way, it's a big change.
Absolutely.
You know, mentally. And that's kind of, I wanted to get kind of how were you able to kind of change that behavior?
So a couple of things are changing, right? So we're working, so it's sensitive, so I can't name the industry or so on and so forth. So there was a fairly large brand, couple of thousand crores odd, who are already working with about 8 odd lenders, right? The reason why they bought us on is obviously they wanted, and they had an army of credit people sitting out there, right? Which basically decided how much of outstanding or exposure can you take on somebody. So the reason they bought somebody like Finovate on is obviously, you know, the fact that we can be fairly, I mean, what we heard from them is the fact that you can be fairly more aggressive as compared to what a bank would traditionally be, right? To onboard all of these guys, because otherwise, with a bank, you know, this is never the core product, right? It is just one additional sale that you do. And, you know, people don't have the incentives to push this kind of product per se. So with us, what happens is, because this is the thing that we do, and we're very intent on doing this correctly, we go all out on it, right? Including providing our tech platform to manage the LOS and LMS if the lender doesn't have the capabilities. We also kind of create the dashboards, which provides a view across all these multiple lenders. So effectively, what they see us as is a single platform through which they can streamline the entire credit process.
So it's like almost you're trying to push on an open door. I mean, from a brand perspective, it is fantastic to have kind of this level of flexibility.
Absolutely, because otherwise, with every lender has got his own requirements in terms of how they look at the world, what cohort do they address, how many documents do they need. When you get somebody like Finovate on board, we kind of just standardize everything, right? And we go with our standard way to all the lenders that we work with, who are our strategic lenders, who we know will work in that fashion. And everything gets managed through my platform. So it just simplifies life, right? And then you can focus on things that grow your business instead of, you know, supporting a credit infrastructure, which is not your core focus.
Absolutely. I mean, you should do well. You should do well what you do well, as you mentioned to me earlier. I want to talk about, there are a few kind of customers that we're working with together, where we are trying to kind of create that value, where we have digitized the entire supply chain and kind of layering a credit management on top of it, which kind of we believe will create significant value for every single player in the ecosystem. So just kind of for the audience, if you have to put kind of how a kind of a timeline view in a place. Let's say somebody decides saying that, you know what, this sounds too good to be true. I think I have to expand in Gujarat, for example. And this has been a particularly challenging kind of for me because I'm not getting the investment that is required. This will work. So what's the process like? How long does it take to get it going? I mean, you said you can be fairly aggressive and fast, but just to kind of share that.
I will be dependent on Bizom for the data in terms of the distributors that you could, and basis your data, the history that's available with other brands, etc. We can figure out, who are the guys who are lendable to that extent. And effectively credit enablement, once the data is available to me, we can get the first disbursement after allocation of the limit within 2 weeks of us deciding to go ahead.
Fantastic.
So this is like setting up a limit which will get used on an ongoing basis.
Fantastic. So if we have a brand, if we kind of digitize the brand, have the availability of the historical data, and that enables you to get going straight away, that the terms will only continue to improve as they transact more and more on Bizom and create even better kind of almost kind of create a better and improve their credit profile over a period of time.
Absolutely. With the segment that we're dealing with, right, they're just grateful they get an unsecured line. They don't really care about better terms.
Absolutely. So let me bring the conversation a little bit to what's happening in the last 60 days or so. And I'm sure everybody kind of was listening, kind of have felt kind of some level of impact. A larger impact this year because of COVID in India than it was last year. It is starting to recover. We can see that, but the numbers for kind of May has been significantly hit. We have 20-50% reduction in sales volume in across categories. Kind of some categories such as personal care and confectionery going down as much as 50%, for example. Now, so in this kind of an environment, how do you help brands? Is this an opportunity or is this a distraction to try and solve this problem today?
I think smart brands have to look at this as an opportunity, right? So like I mentioned earlier, if you have the distribution reach to a particular place, you've got to, first of all, rationalize your SKUs, right? Which I think most people have taken steps on doing, right? I mean, you've got to start looking at your retailer as a partner, and the more you control distribution or more you digitize distribution with that infrastructure being owned by you, right, which is something like what Bizom facilitates, you're able to capture more on-ground intelligence from the retailer, right, and working more closely. And I'm not saying this is switch on a button, it happens tomorrow. But increasingly, this is a battle for the retailer, right? Because the retailer is with the consumer at the end of the day. And and the way things evolve, if you are not controlling that part of the chain, you are always going to be at a disadvantage, right? So we'll come to that part of the conversation subsequently. But the opportunity out here clearly is along the lines of looking at places where you've got reach, where you are actually supplying, and figuring out what else can you supply out there, right? And if and the other important thing is constantly monitoring the lockdown profile, right? And what sells during a lockdown, right? Because I think people have started generating that kind of data. And I'm sure Bizom obviously provides that kind of analytics to your customers, right? So which is very, very key. And this will become extremely important on an ongoing basis, because I think we are going to hit a series of lockdowns in certain geographies, right? To give you an example, we do a fair bit of lending even in UP and Bihar, even in these times, right? And we are constantly monitoring that there are 14 districts that are under lockdown. So we so while we, you know, onboard people, we don't do disbursements at that point. And I'm sure the brands follow a very similar philosophy, which says, I would like to do business with them, but I'm not selling right now, right? And that is why you kind of see the dip. So you will see the rebound once things open up for a while. It'll stabilize. Then you'll go through these peaks and troughs. But but clearly, you know, having the data in a digital format so that you get those dashboards is becoming increasingly critical.
Correct. I mean, so that's quite a pertinent thing. I mean, you are able to, with the data that is available through Bizom, you're able to kind of adjust your, not only your distribution strategy, but also your financing strategy to try and maximize the ROI. You know, one thing I kind of wanted to get your view on, Aljo, is that, I mean, we work with customers all over the world. I mean, we have a presence in over 25 markets. We are working within the Middle East, where kind of we are powering marketplaces where there is a direct engagement with the retailer, and we are working with our partners there to drive that financing for the retailer directly, and helping drive growth for both the brands as well as the retailers. Kind of in your view, in the context in India, how do you see this playing out?
Oh, it's absolutely critical. People don't see it just yet, but effectively, like I said, it's a battle for the interface to talk to the customer right now, right? Let us put it that way. What's happened with the e-commerce thing, right? I mean, with e-commerce out there, with them actually knowing the customer, they're able to price it better, they control the distribution, they're able to launch their private labels. Once they are able to establish demand, there is always something cheaper, right? And that is a game you can't win, right? So it is important as a brand that you are controlling the entire distribution channel. Now, on the other side, what you're also seeing is digital distributors, right? I wouldn't name them, but there's somebody who's come out there and who's basically said that their private label brands, given what they do, and they're present in very small geographies, are at number 3 and number 17 respectively, right? So let's believe what we have to believe. But the truth is, I mean, with scale, with more of these players, unless you're controlling your own distribution and unless you've got access to the retailer and there is some stickiness that you're able to build at that level, you will not be able to play the cheapest price on the shelf game.
The risk is real. I mean, the numbers are probably smaller, as you said, Aljo, but the risk, what you're talking about, the risk is real. And with these digital distributors, the ability or the importance for the brand to not only invest in direct distribution but invest in their partners is equally critical to kind of make the most of it. So I completely kind of get that.
So on that, right, because it's a very important thing. It's a businessman versus an industrialist conversation, right? Which basically said that at one point, I mean, I cared about what goes out of my factory door. I've got my money and I don't care about anything else that happens after that. Yeah. But now just making sure that your ecosystem grows with you and is grateful to you for your business, right? And what you've done to their life is becoming increasingly more important. Yeah. And whoever can capture that and communicate that very clearly is the one who's going to win this game.
Correct. 85% of trade in India is gone through those 15 million independent outlets, kiranas, panwalas, whatever you want to call it.
Correct.
And they have repeatedly been the kind of almost been the savior for that individual consumer who wants that kind of staple for their home, to brands to kind of continue to drive drive that reach and availability in a market like India. So no, I think it makes a lot of sense. Just wanted to touch a little bit on kind of going a bit deeper from an FMCG perspective. Every kind of brand, a number of different kind of sometimes competing objectives that you are trying to achieve. You want to drive reach. You want to get as into as many outlets as possible. But at the same time, you're also trying to maximize kind of your depth, having additional lines, as you talked about, in the outlet. In your examples that you have worked with, how can financing, how can clever or smart use of funds help brands achieve that reach, but also drive depth at a particular kind of region, channel, outlet level even?
Many ways, right? And like I said, each of it is a curated way of looking at it. But specifically, let's think of it. If your brand is not strong in a particular region and you're entering that region, and if the people in the entire financing chain, right? I mean, that's ultimately what the channel finance is, or the sales channel is, are not confident of the speed of rotation, etc. I mean, inevitably, you're going to give credit in the market.
Yeah.
Right. And that is for the first couple of years. Now, assuming you did this using a channel finance route, right, at least 100% of the credit risk doesn't come on your book. If you could bring in an FLDG participation, you can get a lender to come in, right, and put in their money, right, with a certain limited risk at your end, which is anyway controlled. So this basically helps you just make your money go a lot further than it could if you were giving 100% of the credit, right? So assuming you were giving a 20% risk participation, your money in terms of new market expansion goes up 5x, the availability of funds. So I think just a very strategic view to how you kind of look at expansion using money is very, very important. So fundamentally, what we believe is if you've got any sort of capital on your own, be it equity or your own funds, that could necessarily be used for building capacity. Whereas any sort of business that you do, right, and capacity could be distribution, technology, people, whatever else, right, new region, any sort of any sort of BAU that you do should be necessarily done using lender money. That just makes sure that you've got a sufficiently large war chest for times of emergency.
No, I think spot on. I think that kind of you talked about that, and it's a. It, one of the things that you were mentioning to me is that it's a series of steps. I mean, even in the multi-tier, as you said, you start with the stockists, kind of move that, and then their distributors, and then their retailers. So you're not leveraging that same asset multiple times. But even in terms from a brand perspective, you talked about how they can start, with helping drive the value for those kind of channel partners that you have by giving them. Kind of your product availability through better finance, dedicated limits, as you said, before you start to add some of the other slower moving SKUs to try and help kind of widen your or deepen your kind of penetration in that account in that specific outlet, and it's a step by step journey.
Absolutely. So like, if you ask me, what's your strategy got to look like? It's a function of how much money you do have, right? Which is basically money that you can spare after adjusting for all the risk, right? So ideally, otherwise, what you should be utilizing is ideally, if there was limited capital, there's reach that's established. It's all about going deep, right? Getting more SKUs in there, rationalizing those SKUs, increasing your margin for servicing those outlets. And if you and right now, I mean, if you've got the capital available to expand to other regions, obviously it's something that you could look at.
I mean, so there are two parts to the coin. I mean, you want to be able to make sure that the capital is available for the distributors so that they can help drive push more and more to the outlet, so that they have the capital, they can actually stock, and then, but at the same time, you want to ensure that they are able to service the retailers properly. So you are driving that stock turn, more and more stock turn for the distributors, not having them limit their ability to service by having the capital available. So combination of kind of what we do at Bizom in terms of ensuring that service quality is kind of paramount through complete digitization and availability of financing as and when needed, ensuring that that there is no kind of blockages in that supply chain. So combination is kind of essentially what will help drive growth for the brand. Have I got you correctly?
Absolutely, and there are more angles to this, right? And it's very fascinating, and we'll have to see how this evolves, right? But it's a very interesting time in Indian FMCG, right? Because also what you've got to realize is with the digital distributors, aggregators, name it, right? You know what all is afoot out there, and I think everyone out here will know what all is afoot out there, right? Yeah. So I'll not get into that. You've got a very limited time to put your own dedicated credit limit at the retailer.
Yeah.
Or at the distributor, because any platform that's going to go out there is going to put a multi-brand limit out there.
Yeah, correct.
And if you've not put it right now and you've not captured the retailer at this stage, at a later stage, you will not be able to push an exclusive limit.
It is. And I think this is a kind of a constant kind of battle of innovation, how fast you can innovate as a brand and kind of drive those changes in the ecosystem. Ultimately, you want to get to the consumers, and you need to benefit, kind of move away from that push that you typically do, where you're just giving, as you said, finance to the stockists and that's it, and then they are trying to push. It's all push, as opposed to a pull, which the consumers can pull and then completely demand based, essentially how we would drive.
Absolutely. So you can just see how this is going, right? I mean, like, for instance, if there's a platform that starts putting that limit out there, the next they have is a dedicated consumer limit. Once you have that, you can actually dictate the brands that have to be a part of that, right? Classic coalition loyalty 101, right? So unless you're not playing, if you're not playing this game, you've not put your own distribution out there, you've not put your own technology out there, you might be left out.
Yeah. So we are coming closer to the 40 minutes. There are a few things which I wanted to ask before we take the questions from the audience. Let's say you have a CEO of a dairy brand, who, as I said, is a growing business looking to expand. Have listened to all the great points that you've made. What is the the three pieces of advice that you will give a brand? And on what they should do, how they should go about it.
Aljo, we can't hear you.
Sorry, my mistake. From a dairy standpoint, and I know this largely because I've been involved in setting up a dairy business earlier, right? It's important to minimize the cold chain, right? You have to collect as close to the source as possible. So it's important for you to develop these various milking sources that could be available to you, milking regions that are available to you. Mm-hmm. That is possible only if you free up your capital, right? Mm-hmm. A lot, and every brand has got a different style, but a few of them have that model wherein they are basically keeping deposits and essentially they're basically servicing deposits and so on and so forth. It's a complete distraction, right? And they've been limited to certain regions or whatever else it could be. Yeah. So I think if I was doing this, I would typically free up their capital, get in lender capital in to manage that entire thing, and basically start developing those newer sources, right? So that your distribution is not very far flung, right? For instance, you're not transporting from the south of India to the north of India, which never happens, but largely you develop more of these little buckets so that you don't need that cold chain, or you have smaller cold chains that are possible across the length and breadth of India.
Yeah. I mean, to a certain degree, dairy kind of needs cold chain. However, if you think about distribution for any kind of distribution, be it food, kind of beverage, or all of those kind of, to a certain degree, what you're talking about applicable to it. Pretty much everybody.
Absolutely. The other thing on the dairy part is also the entire investment that's needed from a bulk cooler standpoint, right? So just ensuring that capital is available to those people who are supporting you from a bulk cooler setup standpoint is also very, very important.
Correct. I mean, it's an asset heavy kind of a vertical in some ways, which Correct. Is typically investment is done from the brands. Actually, so it's another interesting question. I mean, in terms of are there kind of conditions or limits in terms of how the financing can be used, or it can be pretty much on any spend that brand does? Because brand, it could be based on inventory, it could be based on some of the merchandising activities that you're doing, BTL activities doing. Is there any limit that you think that the financing can be applied to?
So our ability to price the limit correctly is a function of the end use, right? So the more restrictive you are in terms of end use, the better we can get at pricing, right?
Correct.
So while
Correct.
There is no limit in terms of what we can do and what we can't do as a part of that particular limit, it is better to be very specific when you're dealing with the lender so that you don't change the risk profile too much.
Correct. So you may choose to kind of use financing for assets, like I'm going to go and put 5,000 freezers in these outlets in this kind of part of the country, and that's what I want to drive, and then yes, fine. Or I may want to be able to drive kind of stock availability or better norms of kind of inventory norms at these distribution points. It's fine. Trying to kind of be specific, but the range can be as wide as it.
Absolutely. So what I would not do is say that, you know, one single limit to set up assets, marketing, all of that, because then it becomes Correct. Extremely complex, right? And that's Correct. Where a lot of these financial conversations are lost with lenders. So we kind of break this down and then we kind of create risk profiles. Like, for instance, if I'm funding marketing, if you've got data that kind of correlates the marketing spend with the revenue coming in, it becomes easier. If you don't have that, it becomes tough, right?
Correct.
Different
Correct.
For different brands. Whereas I know if I'm using it for inventory, I know what your historical sales are. I know what's going to come in, right? So it becomes a very different conversation.
Correct.
From an asset standpoint, if you're financing that asset in a new region where you've got no historical data, completely different conversation, right?
Correct.
Now,
Correct.
If you're doing that in conjunction with a platform like Vizom, who could tell me what the demand looks like, very different conversation. So there are multiple ways to cut this.
Yeah, I mean, I'm thinking about that entire 30 to 50% and the entire price waterfall. If I look at a price waterfall for a SKU, then there are investments being made in number of different elements, which ultimately adds up to that. And obviously, digitization will help you make it far more efficient, far more optimized. But it also gives you visibility on what ROI you are generating, because, you know, things like I want to have 20 different facings of my SKU in a modern trade outlet. There is a cost to it.
Correct.
At the end of the day, so there is a cost from the retailer to you. There is a cost of your own teams to kind of manage and maintain that. But it is a kind of proven, you know, jo dikhta hai wo bikta hai. It's kind of a very simple proven fact. With Bizom, people can measure it. And as soon as they can measure it, what you are saying is that then they can finance it.
Absolutely. And the other important piece clearly, we didn't probably intend to talk about that piece. What I'm increasingly realizing is control over the source, right? So effectively, if you control the source for milk, you control it, right? Then a private label becomes dependent on you. So increasingly controlling that source and using finance to do that becomes important. From a marketing standpoint, just the merchandising piece that you touched upon, one is, I mean, to block your capital for that period, right? By putting money up front. The second is to use a limit and then see ki return kitna aaya, right?
Correct.
So it's a combination of these things. So basically, you can just change your working profile completely by just using limits very smartly.
Yeah, no, but it is fascinating to hear that kind of lot of these variables go in. It might sound complex, and it is complex because the ecosystem is complex in itself. However, with the level of data that is available today, with the ability for us to be able to pinpoint to almost 200 to 200 meter square, saying that there is an opportunity here, all of that we are doing, so that richness of information is there, and Absolutely. Hence it should help us to kind of jointly drive that kind of right level of financing or capital management for customers.
So let me give you examples of this, right? So classically, you know, earlier almost every VC worth a salt wanted his platform to become a fintech, right? but over a period of time, what's happened, and with a lot of these platforms as well, when they kind of went out there, had those lender conversations, etc., what they realized is the lenders stop entertaining them after some time. You just don't get any answers. So what's important is you realize that people are coming from very different worlds, right? While you might see the logic, what you need to appreciate is how the credit committees work at the credit side, right? So just bridging that conversation so that people can talk the same language is typically what we do at Finovate Capital. And now you kind of 10x that, because we do it across multiple lenders, and then we bring them all onto our platform.
No, it's fantastic. It's kind of quite an exciting change that this can bring to the whole industry. It is not just about, you know, financing a distributor. It is about changing the game completely. It's about not only improving your distribution reach, but strengthening your relationships that you have with these channel partners and ultimately retailers and consumers. So the impact is quite can be quite far-fetched, kind of if planned and done properly.
Important to do it, largely because of the sort of deep pockets that are coming in who are chipping away at different parts. It's a matter of time before they do this entire thing.
So as a
brand, you can't afford to kind of ignore that for too long, because otherwise it'll become just too late.
Absolutely. I'm sure everybody has heard you loud and clear. Mansi, just wanted to check if we have questions. Should we move to questions and answers for the next kind of 10 minutes or so?
Yeah, so we have a few questions here. I'll just show the questions on the stage. The first question is, and I think this question is open to both of you, Krishna and Ajo. The question is, how do you think an organization can drive organic buying? What can one imbibe in the RDM strategy? To start with, Aljo, do you want to start?
So I think this is clearly right up Bizom's alley, right? I mean, in terms of what you all do, right? While Krishna can talk about it, I can just touch upon it briefly. But effectively, I think Bizom's already doing this today, because now suddenly when a person can't, you know, actually visit physically, right? Or when a salesperson can't visit the store physically to take an order, ultimately just giving the retailer the power and the marketplace behind to place the order directly, getting those loyalty points in there to kind of hook them. And just ensuring that if there is any sort of trade promotion that's available as going straight to the retailer, I think these are things that Bizom's already doing today, right? I'm sure Krishna can talk more about it than me.
You put it really well, Aljo. So I think, Prateek, fundamentally, it's about how you bring a kind of a combination of strategies. Sometimes we call it a multi-touch strategy, where you are engaging the retailers through a number of different channels. It's a mix of channels. You're not just relying on salespeople to go and take orders. It's a combination of things, engaging with the retailers, giving loyalty, cashback, right kind of schemes and promotions. There are many different ways in which you have to engage and get that mind share with the retailer to adopt that self-ordering. And there are some phenomenal examples that already exist across the world. I mean, India, there are many plus, we are doing a few in Middle East, Africa, and Southeast Asia as well, where this change is happening because you are, digital adoption is actually not that difficult. It is about making the right capabilities available to your retail partners. And as Aljo said, making the right investment available to those retailers, whether that's a cashback or whether that's a loyalty scheme or whatever it might be. Hope that helps answer your question, Prateek.
Yeah.
Manshi, we can move to the next one.
Yeah, the next question is from Jatin, and he's asking, what is the basis of evaluating a distributor for financing?
So I think the most fundamental basis is association with you. Right. How long has he been associated with you? How much of business has he been doing with you? What does the dependency look like? Right. So tomorrow, if you do stop supplying to him, what are the alternatives available to him? Right. So we use that as the fundamental question. Once we are able to determine that, then we figure out whether this model is financeable by itself. Right. And or then we create the right risk participation elements to make sure the lenders get the right kind of assurance. So it's a combination of all of this. Once we start there, and if there is a fair amount of comfort established, and when we kind of realize that there isn't a need to go much deeper into individual balance sheet assessment of a distributor, we can keep it fairly light. If the comfort is not derived at that point to that extent, obviously then you have to get into bureau and balance sheets and ITRs and all those good things. So it's a function of how the entire channel finance has been, or the channel sales channel itself has been structured. Does that answer the question?
Very clear to me, Ajay. Very clear.
Moving to the next question, which is this. And the question is, how much skin must brands have in the game to ensure a competitive interest rate for their channel partners?
Well, that's a very interesting one, right? So fundamentally, if you think of it, right, if any program has got a default more than 5%, you will stop the program, right? So at any point, a brand does not have more than that at risk, right? Because beyond that, no one's going to, you know, encourage that bloodbath. But having said that, from a lender standpoint, if you're able to provide close to a 15-20% FLDG, you're able to kind of just more from a pricing standpoint, you just make the program a lot easier from a structuring standpoint. So the documentation requirements could come down significantly. As an example, you could potentially decide to run the program digitally if you're able to bring in this kind of risk participation. There are cohorts who could not have been included otherwise, who suddenly become, it becomes possible to include largely because, you know, the skin in the game is being bought by the brand. Not so much a pricing conversation.
Very interesting.
The next question came onto the chat. I've just pasted it here. The question is, what is the business model for such financing?
So we clearly don't charge anything to the brand. We don't charge anything. So no one else but the lender pays. Yeah. So that's largely the model. Even for the lender, effectively, effectively from our standpoint, if it's Finovate's model that I'm answering, it's basically we have a share of interest and we have a share of processing fee, and this is largely because the entire thing is managed on our platform. Because most lenders largely don't have these sort of platforms to manage these kind of loans. Mm-hmm. I mean, apart from the top few banks, right? Is that the question per se, or is it more from from the perspective of the bank or the distributor?
Maybe I would request the.
It makes sense to me. I think.
Yeah.
I think Alvin has probably asked that question, so hopefully.
Sure. More so. Okay. He replied, and he's saying more so from the Finovate perspective.
Perfect. So I think that's the part that I answered. Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. The next question is this.
Yeah, so I mean, like I said, I mean, currently we are at 0% NPA, and we intend to keep it that way, right? But largely, like I said, every program that we get into, you start off with the safer cohorts, right? And you start building comfort on the basis of that. So again, the strength of the brand, the dependency, all those good things that come in, right? So if we are not convinced, we do not take it to our lending partners, right? Because we play a credibility game. And the moment we lose our credibility, the next time we go to our lender partners, they're not going to, you know, entertain us, right? So I think just being completely assured from our standpoint, which says if it's our capital, would we still go out there and give the money, right? Is how we look at it. I'm not sure whether that's a great answer, but that's, it is not so much about the opportunity. It's more about knowing what business to do right now. And largely what you should be saying no to.
Sometimes that's far more important, Aljo.
Oh, we say no to a lot more than what we say yes to.
Showing up the next question, which is, yes, yeah.
Yes, absolutely. I think this is what we touched upon, right? Krishna, would you like to take it, or would you?
Yeah, no, I think absolutely. I think critical part of what kind of brands need to do is to obviously learn from what's happening, both kind of in the current week or month, but also looking at historical data, seasonalities, to try and understand, you know, how can what's coming up. You know that the Diwali season is going to come up. You know that there is going to be a demand for beverages as we hit peak summer. So some of that kind of predictions is actually quite reasonably possible to do within BizOM. Working along with Finovate, we can also make sure that brands and their channel partners are well equipped with capital in advance to drive that availability of the right products for the right outlets to serve the right consumer segment that they're looking for.
The next question is now, and says, what are the different programs or product that Finovate offers?
So we work on both the payables and receivables, and so ultimately ultimately, the way we look at it is traditionally, when we take a company, how can we move them to almost like a negative working capital cycle, right? So for example, what we say is, assuming you pay your suppliers on day 15 and you get paid from the market only on day 45, you're out of money for 30 days, right? So to bridge those 30 days worth of gap, what can I do, right? The intervention could either be, you know, paying your suppliers on a certain period and getting a payment extension for you as a company to cover that, you know, time when you're out of pocket. Or alternatively, you know, the moment you sell, I pay you on day one and I collect from the market subsequently. So whatever is needed to kind of structure that product is what we kind of put together and manage on our platform. Additionally, what we also do is, especially with platforms that we work with, as you know, like for instance, if with Bizom as an example, if you want to onboard smaller FMCG companies, right, who typically would not, or smaller brands who are just starting out, right, who can't afford the sort of, you know, capital that's needed to kind of pay upfront, or they would like to space out their working capital requirements. We could almost run a buy now pay later program, right, where we kind of break the payment down into EMIs as an example. So these are the sort of interventions that we do. It is not specifically a product, but it's just, given our technology flexibility, our ability to work with lenders, we can create almost anything or construct that is needed to kind of do, have a significant impact on your working capital profile.
Makes sense.
Yeah. That was the last question. Krishna, do you want to add anything?
No, I think it was a fabulous discussion, Aljo. Lovely insights from you. Hopefully all our audience who have been able to make today or not can kind of follow us on, follow the updates, as you will see from this fascinating discussion. So thank you, Aljo. Thank you so much.
Hey, thanks so much for having me, and enjoyed the chat as well.
Yeah. Thank you, Aljo. Thank you, Krishna, for being part of the webinar. Audience, if you have any questions that you want to ask from the speakers, please send that to us at marketing@mobizy.com. And this is our LinkedIn page. This is the place where you can find all most of the insights related to the industry, some great opinion pieces. Please do follow us here. And until we meet soon, please do take care of yourselves. Thank you, Aljo. Thank you, Krishna.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
See you all. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.